Thanks very much. Today's reading is taken from the book of Inconvenient People, Lunacy, Liberty and Mad Doctors in Victorian England, page 62. So, John Percival, the son of Prime Minister Spencer Percival, has finally managed to extricate himself from the asylums that his family put him in after he got involved with a religious cult. He's gone to Paris and he's written a book about his experiences. Mr. Percival believed that patients were best placed to inform their carers of the nature of the problem, and instead of ridiculing the seeming nonsense of the patient's speech, what was required was a sympathetic attempt to unravel the source of distress. The task was best undertaken by those who knew the patient well. Family, old friends, or general physicians of long acquaintance. It was no task to be given to a money-minded, vainglorious stranger. A lunatic was an individual with an individual cause of his or her own illness and required an individually tailored attempt at cure. Many persons confined as lunatics are only so because they are not understood and continue so because they do not understand themselves, he wrote. Instead, lunatics had to surrender their bodies and minds to the doctors who were permitted to work their mischief or test their misguided and unproven theories upon them. So, this is a long time before Lang and Sachs and all that stuff, but I think we've got antipsychiatry in a nutshell, really. Vainglorious strangers imposing their own narrow-minded ideas onto people who were not understood because they had been traumatized, they had been somehow disconnected from normality, whatever it was at that time. And, you know, one of the things that is worth noting about that is he first published the book anonymously and it was ignored. It was only when he put his own name to it that some copies were bought. So, you know, this is one of the things, is whose voices are we listening to and how do we get more voices that aren't white, powerful men? You know. So fast forward to now, how have we done, having, you know, had that outline for us, there's a way to treat mental distress. I get a call last week from a guy I've been talking to for a while in the Greater Manchester area. He's in a hospital. 12 staff have held him down and injected him on the wall, you know, and he doesn't trust the staff and he doesn't trust the medication. How is this still happening? Where's the peer support? Where's the advocacy? Where are all these safeguards that we have called for and demanded? You know, barbarism is still happening in 2017. The case of Miss C was reported, a trans woman who went to Southmead Hospital in Bristol and pleaded for help from her mental health team because she felt suicidal, and they turned her away. So she tried to commit suicide, and she got arrested. She got into a cell where she was stripped by male officers, and she was misgendered, and she was abused. I hear of people who have self-harmed going into A&E and being patched up without local anaesthetic. It is bad enough that people hurt themselves. We do not have to hurt them afterwards. We have to show, have compassion and care. Sir Simon Worsley is leaving as the president of the Royal College of Psychiatrists, and that's a good thing. He's been tied up in this austerity agenda and it's disgusting. His contribution on the lingering is horrible. But, you know, in his parting interview, he calls for 1,000 more psychiatrists. And I say, no, that is not what we need. What we need now is we need to be given spaces where community grassroots initiatives can set up crisis centres so that people who are in absolute distress and trauma are not forced to go to A&E and be treated like shit, but are going to be received, are going to be fed, are going to be treated with compassion, and are going to be listened to, and their needs are going to be identified with help and met. You know, and this is breaking away from the whole thing of vainglorious strangers, from people who earn reasonable salaries to signpost and gatekeep. You know, how many of us are going for help and being asked questions like, what do you expect us to do? You know, I'm here because I don't know what to do. I'm at the end of my fucking tether and you want me to tell you what your job is? We've got people being asked, why haven't you killed yourself yet? You know, in benefits interviews, in interrogations, they're not interviews, they're not assessments, they are political interrogations. And, you know, not what, you know, what methods do you use to stop yourself from killing yourself, but why haven't you done it yet? Almost as if you've been urged to go and do it, you know. So, I'm going to end there, but yeah, antipsychiatry, I think, you know, it's an old paradigm and it's got to end. The future is professionals retraining themselves, listening to the experts by experience, the people who've been at the hard end of it, who've been incarcerated, who've been held down and rejected, who've had shots put through their head, and listening to them and finally listening to what they think the solutions are and implementing them. Thanks very much.
I'm just wondering what we do in the meantime until we have those spaces that are safe and that aren't psychiatrically called, whatever you want to call it. Because I had some of those experiences that you talked about, and they have been really traumatic, but I also still have crises quite regularly, and if I'm not safe at home, where can I go? What hospital? And it's a real struggle to kind of get help from a system that I fundamentally struggle with. What else can I do? So I just wonder what your thoughts are on that.
I don't have the answers. I mean, I walk around a lot of the time in a state that I lived in section for 2 decades ago, and I'm just there. And, you know, I've built my own support network around me. I have people I really care. I think what's worked for me is getting involved in the campaigning and beginning to understand, and I think this is different to what some other speakers said, that it's not just about taking personal responsibility, but about understanding this is a systemic problem. What's happening to you, what's happening to me? The same thing's happening to too many people for it to be our fault. This is the system's fault. And the system has to change, and there's signs of it, you know. We're seeing right now this big fight between May and Corbyn. Oh, Jeremy Corbyn. You know, the will of the people does seem to be moving towards a more compassionate and gentle society. But my answer is, we try and identify professionals and people that we can work with on a different basis and who we can turn to in times of crisis, and we try our best not to go to A&E. We try to set up local initiatives where people can come and see us, you know, for help.
Can I imagine that on the internet, when you're really feeling isolated and you don't want anything to do with psychiatry and you're being treated, there are one or two forums, and one of them has to be recovery in the pen.
Absolutely.
Where you can feel supported by people, where you can voice what you're going through, where you can be supported by individuals.
Yeah. No, definitely recovery in the bin for people who don't know it. It's a secret group for all sorts of reasons, but once you're in there, it is a great source of support. And there, you know, all sorts of new distance-based things are being set up, but I still really think we need to start looking at setting up local initiatives all over the place and skill sharing and helping each other to do that. Thanks very much. Thank you.